we've got Jim Michaelis, who's giving me. Jim has coerced me into reading this thing. It's not my idea, but here it goes. And I quote, "It happened in the back seat of a 37 Chevrolet. All the bars were closed in Missoula, Montana. 9 months later, Jim was born." His first mother didn't like the way her baby looked, so she put him up for adoption. For the first 11 days, there were no takers, and Jim thought about hiring an attorney. He didn't know who to sue. The parents who made the mistake of adopting him moved to Salem, Oregon, and Jim decided to go with them. Second grade, Jim was disciplined by a teacher for talking too much and disrupting class. Teacher came up with a solution. In front of the whole class, she walked where Jim was sitting, opened his mouth, and stuffed paper in his mouth. This worked. He couldn't talk with paper in his mouth. When he was 13, he played baseball, pitched a no-hit-run game. His athletic career went downhill from there. Somehow, he became senior class president of his high school, and somehow, he was admitted to Stanford, the law school, University of California in Berkeley. Jim became captain in the Army, serving in West Germany. His first job as a lawyer was deputy district attorney for the county of Sacramento, where he learned how not to try a jury case. Eventually specialized in defense of aviation accidents, became single-engine land private pilot. In 1982, elected president of the Los Angeles chapter of Aviation Insurance Association. He was not reelected. Today's the fifth time Jim's been selected to be speaker of our OFA conference. Hopefully, it will be the last. Jim retired 3 years ago at age of 82. If you're not completely turned off by now, and are still awake, I present our next speaker, Jim Michaelis.
In conclusion, this is a baseball town. Johnny Bench, this might even be the Johnny Bench meeting room. Catcher for the Cincinnati Reds was born in Oklahoma. Warren Spahn, who you young guys probably never heard of, but he was a big deal when I was playing baseball in high school. Warren Spahn was a left-handed pitcher for the Milwaukee Brewers. Was not born in Oklahoma, but he retired here. And of course, the most famous of the baseball players from Oklahoma is Mickey Mantle. Around Oklahoma City, there is Mickey Mantle Drive, Mickey Mantle Restaurant, Mickey Mantle this, Mickey Mantle that. There's a statue, a wonderful statue of him within walking distance, right outside the Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame. The elephant in the room, the last time I was a speaker, the conference was held in Santa Fe, New Mexico. The elephant in the room there was the Los Alamos National Laboratory, where the atomic bomb was developed. And since then, the film Oppenheimer has come out. The elephant in the room here in Oklahoma is Native Americans. 42% of the land of Oklahoma. It seems kind of high to me, but that's what I read. 42% of the land of Oklahoma is in the hands of Native Americans of various tribes. Okay, let's get on with this.
The other stands, 9, 8, 7, 8, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and liftoff of Space Shuttle Atlantis to assemble the framework science laboratories of tomorrow.
Houston, now controlling.
Houston, has several programs.
Thank you.
the baseball field, and basically that is our hotel. Oklahoma was first made famous nationwide by the 1943 Broadway play by that name. And in 1955, that Broadway play was made into a movie starring the beautiful Shirley Jones and the handsome Gordon McRae. If you flew into the Oklahoma City airport to get here, this is a picture right in front of the elevators that is some very beautiful artwork. Any sports fans in here? Raise your hand if you're a sports fan. A few weeks ago, Oklahoma University football team was ranked number one in the nation. They're now ranked about number seven or so, but they were ranked number one in Topeka, Texas. That's very impressive. And of course, we are adjacent to the Los Angeles Dodgers, Oklahoma City Dodgers. Baseball field is a subsidiary or affiliated with the Los Angeles Dodgers. And I think we talked earlier about Johnny Bench and Warren Spahn. The Oklahoma City Thunder, the NBA team, has a rising star, Chet Holmgren, 7'1". Whoa. Who can do everything. I watched him when he was a freshman at Gonzaga University in Spokane, Washington. I watched him on television. Chet Holmgren is possibly going to be the MVP of the NBA someday, perhaps. Okay, close by are the National Stockyards. And a few years ago, the authorities permitted cattle to run wild down the street like this. I think that's probably not permitted today. I don't really know. Probably the lawyers squelched it with liability concerns. Having been a lawyer, I understand that. Cattleman's Cafe. How many of you have been to the Cattleman's Cafe? One, two. All right. I ate there a few days ago. Great service, great foods. Super Western attire right there. Okay, we're going to Oklahoma history and Oklahoma flying machines after that introduction. Here's the state flag, the state bird, the scissor tail flycatcher. I had to learn how to pronounce that. State animal is the bison, otherwise known as the buffalo. And a couple of interesting firsts in the state of Oklahoma, first in the nation. One is the very first Boy Scout troop in the entire United States was started here in 1909. The second Oklahoma first. This is the very first pointing meter in the United States.
Well, that was a cheap 5 cents.
I'm glad you said that. Those in the back probably can't see this, but right in there, from 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. is a nickel.
That was expensive.
Yeah, I think it's more expensive than a nickel today. Okay, let's talk about some famous people from Oklahoma. We'll start with Will Rogers. If you flew in here, you landed at the Will Rogers Airport. He was a humorous social commentator in the 1930s. One of the quotes that he is famous for is, oh, by the way, he was one-eighth Cherokee, so he's He was born in Indian Territory before 1879, way before this area became a state. Anyway, he's quoted as saying that my ancestors did not come over on the Mayflower, but they met the boat. Ask if there should be presidential debates. He says, yes, joint debates, in any joint you like. And then he said, a humorist entertains, a lecturer annoys. And I hope that you won't regard me as a lecturer. Okay.
He also said, it's a good thing we don't get all the government paid for it.
Will Rogers apparently had an unlimited number of funny things that he said. That's what made him popular. Will Rogers and Wally Post became friends. You could say maybe they became too good of friends because they died together on August 15, 1935, near Point Barrow, Alaska.
He died on his birthday.
When Wally Post aircraft had a difficulty taking off from a lake and it plunged upside down into the lake, and they both were killed instantly. At Point Barrow, there is a monument. If you want to go all the way to Point Barrow, Alaska, which is like in the north end of Alaska, you can witness the memorial for this accident. June Thorpe is in Oklahoma. He was born in Indian Territory. June Thorpe is regarded still as one of the best athletes ever in the United States. He was the first Native American to win a gold medal in the Olympics. We're talking about the 1912 Olympics held in Stockholm, Sweden. And when he was being presented with this gold medal by the King of Sweden, the King said to Jim Thorpe, "Sir, you are the greatest athlete in the world." And Jim Thorpe replied, "Thank you." There's a Jim Thorpe Museum within walking distance of here. It's a little section of the Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame. I went to see the Jim Thorpe Museum in the Hall of Fame. It's very, very worthwhile visiting. There's a statue of Jim Thorpe that you can see just a block or so from here. He played professional baseball for the New York Giants. He played basketball and of course, he won the decathlon, 10 events. Another famous Oklahoman is Maria Talchi, from the Osage Nation. And she became a prima ballerina. And a prima ballerina, I learned, is the highest rank or category of ballerinas. And the last part of the screen is a picture of the United States quarter coin that the U.S. Mint issued just last year in honor of Maria Talchi. Patty Page was from Oklahoma. And for those of you who are over 70 here in the room, you might remember the song Tennessee Waltz. If you're younger, you've probably never heard of Tennessee Waltz. I never heard of this guy, Bill Polk, that's how he pronounced his last name, an astronaut from Oklahoma. In 1974, he spent 84 days in space in Skylab 4. Of course, Mickey Mantle, I think we've talked about Mickey Mantle enough. There's a statue of him outside the Oklahoma Sports
Hall of Fame near the Ken Forrest statue. Another famous Oklahoman is Roger Miller, who was made famous by his rendition of King of the Road, one of my favorite songs. Vince Gill.
Oh, yeah.
Apparently, he was with the Eagles before he went off on his own. And has a beautiful voice. And right outside the hotel, perpendicular, is Vince Gill Avenue. Garth Brooks.
Yeah.
Let's see if we can get some sound here. A lot of people are name droppers and talk about famous people that they knew. Here's Garth Brooks talking about all the people he knew who are in low places. I love that topic. Oh, Reba McEntire is from Oklahoma, and she came out with a book just in the last year or so, and to my surprise, the foreword to Reba McEntire's book is written by Garth Brooks. You may not have ever heard of Stephen Hillenburg. Raise your hand if you've heard of him. One person, two persons, three persons, okay. He was born at Fort Sill, and he was the inventor of this. SpongeBob SquarePants. Maybe your grandchildren or children are became a fan of the SpongeBob SquarePants.
Just him saying that.
And Brad Pitt, ugly Hollywood actor.
Poor thing.
Was born in Shawnee, Oklahoma. Let's talk about the concept or the dream of manifest destiny. Manifest destiny was a belief that white settlers were ordainedly justified in going west and taking over lands that had been occupied by Native Americans for hundreds and hundreds of years. Manifest destiny is a colonial concept that was used by white Europeans throughout the world to justify their taking over and dominating people and countries and other places. Here is something that. Raise your hand if you read this book, Sex and Manifest Destiny. Just kidding. Here is what I regard as a beautiful painting of the concept of manifest destiny. This lady is carrying a Bible in her right hand, and in her left hand, she's carrying telegraph wire. Expanding the telegraph communication westward as everybody wants west. And I'm sure you've heard of the saying, "Go west, young man." That's part of manifest destiny. Okay, this is the way the United States looks in 1822. See that Oklahoma is not mentioned anywhere on this map because it didn't exist then. Another interesting thing
interesting to me, is right here, this is Russian America. All of Alaska was owned by Russia, and I think Secretary of State Seward, S-E-W-A-R-D, I believe, may have negotiated the purchase of Alaska from Russia. Okay. Before Oklahoma became a state, it was called, the area we're in is called the Indian Territory. And the Indian Territory is lower right, Oklahoma Territory, upper. And the rest of it is our Indian tribes occupying the land. And right up here is the Osage tribe. We're going to be talking about the Osage Nation of Oshawa's tribe later on. Okay, this is what the white settlers regarded when they moved westward and found some farming land that they liked, displacing the Native Americans, and they would just say, it's mine. The Indian Removal Act of 1830 was an act of Congress signed into law by President Andrew Jackson in 1830, and it resulted in the removal of Native American tribes from primarily the Southeast to Indian territory. They called the Trail of Tears, and there were many Trails of Tears, not just a few of them. Even Native American tribes in the state of Oregon, where I'm from, were forced to move, to walk over 2,000 miles to Oklahoma Indian Territory. In 1831, I'll talk about this in a second. In 1831, a French citizen by the name of Alexis de Tocqueville came to the United States just to observe what was going on in 1831. And he wrote a paper or a book called Democracy in America. And Tocqueville actually, in 1831, witnessed the removal of the Choctaw tribe from Tennessee. And here's what he said about what he witnessed. In the whole scene, there was an air of ruin and destruction. One couldn't watch without feeling one's heart wrung. And a soldier who participated in the removal said as follows. I fought through wars and have seen men shot to pieces and slaughtered by thousands. The Cherokee removal was the cruelest work I ever knew. Fast forward to 1987, the National Park Service established a Trail of Tears, a National Historic Trail. The trail is over 2,000 miles long and covers nine states. Okay, this is a map showing several of the Trail of Tears. The Seminoles from Central Florida mostly went by boat up to Mississippi or Louisiana. And all these yellow lines in this map here are trails of tears of various tribes heading into the Oklahoma area. Here's a kind of dramatic, sad painting showing the Native Americans being herded by what happened? Okay, let's talk about Harper Lee's To Kill a Mockingbird instead of my subject. I'll get back on the track here. Okay, I might need some time to talk here. Let's see how I get back here. Yeah. Thank you. You did it. Thank you very much. Okay. Many of the Native Americans who were forced to leave their homelands to go to the Oklahoma area died on the way. There's snow on the ground here. They didn't have adequate clothing or food. Some of them starved to death on the way. Oklahoma did not become a state until 1907. It was the 46th state, and the reason why it became a state so late is because there were some controversies in Congress. The eastern states, the representatives and senators of the eastern states disagreed with the representatives senators from the southern states. And another factor in delaying statehood was that the Native Americans living in the area wanted to create their own state, and they wanted to call it Sequoia, State of Sequoia, named after the Cherokee member who invented the Sequoia alphabet. In any event, in 1907, it did become a state rather than two states, and here we are. Oklahoma today is surrounded by seven states, starting in the upper left-hand corner: Colorado, Kansas, Missouri, Arkansas, Texas, and New Mexico. And today in the United States Congress, to give you some perspective here, Oklahoma has 5 representatives, New York 26, and California 52. That's the
problem. That last 1 year.
Let's talk about oil in Oklahoma. Oil became, and still is, a big deal, to say the least. That's an understatement in the state of Oklahoma. For about 30 years, Oklahoma was the top oil producer in the entire United States. John Paul Getty got his start with a little tiny oil well in Oklahoma, and his, you've heard of Getty Oil Company, started right here. In Tulsa, there's a 70-foot high statue of an oil worker. I've never been to Tulsa, but if I go there, that's one of the first things I'd like to see, the 70-foot tall oil worker. And in the name of the Oklahoma, of the Tulsa minor league baseball team is the Drillers. Okay, now we get into another dark black mark chapter in Oklahoma history, and just to let you know, I'm going to be talking about some positive, happy things that occurred in Oklahoma after I get through with the negative things.
Okay.
So it's not all negative. The oil discovered on the reservation of the Osage Nation, the oil belonged to the Osage tribal members, because they were able to negotiate in such a way that the mineral rights of their land belonged to them. They negotiated that before they even knew there was any oil underneath their land. was discovered on the North Side of the Nation. Here's where the North Side tribe and nation is located. This is their seal. The Osage tribal members became very, very rich. They, per capita, they were the richest group of people in the entire United States. In 1 year, the royalties paid to the Osage tribal members was $30 million, which translates in current dollars to about $400 million. The Osage tribal members had chauffeurs, they built mansions, they sent their children to private schools, including schools in Europe. And here's a picture of this is self-explanatory. Man with his feather in his cap there, driving a convertible. And there first, there have been and still are some very famous members of the Osage Nation. I think you might find this of interest. One of them became the Vice President of the United States. Mm. His name was Charles Curtis, and he was Vice President under President Herbert Hoover, 1929 to 1933. Another famous Osage tribal member was Jerry Elliott, who was a physicist and one of the first Native Americans in NASA. And he received the Presidential Medal of Freedom for his actions in saving the lives of three astronauts aboard Apollo 13. The current mayor of Oklahoma City, where we are right now, is an Osage tribal member. His name is David Holt. We talked about Maria Tall Chief, the ballerina. And there's one more famous Osage tribal member that I came across preparing this. Charles Tinker. Ever heard of Tinker Air Force Base?
Mm-hmm.
Named after him. And Charles Tinker was an aviation officer who died during World War II during the Battle of Midway. He achieved the rank of Major General, and he's the first American Native America. Okay. It's a big however, talking about how wealthy the Osage Native members were. However, they begin to be murdered one by one. And a book was written about it called Killers of the Flower Moon. And last week, October 20, I believe, a movie by the same name came out. Killers of the Flower Moon, sorry, Leonardo DiCaprio, Robert De Niro, and Lily Gladstone. And at first, no one knew who was murdering the Osage tribal members. There's not one a week or one a month. The Oklahoma justice system and law enforcement personnel did not investigate. They were asked to investigate by the Osage and they refused. So for years, no one was held accountable. Eventually, the Osage tribal members went to Washington, D.C. and asked for the assistance of the Bureau of Enforcement, which later became the FBI. And the investigation of these murders became the first significant criminal investigation of the
new federal bureau of investigation. J. Edgar Hoover was just a young man at that time. He got his start because of the killings in Oklahoma, the OFA. Okay, here's another terrible part of Oklahoma history. The Tulsa Race Massacre of Black people in 1921. In Tulsa, there was, and maybe still is, an area, a reception called Greenville. And Greenville became known as the Black Wall Street because there were many successful African-American businessmen residing in the Greenville district of Tulsa who became quite wealthy, and that's where the name came from, the Black Wall Street. Well, in 1921, a little incident occurred that exploded into a big incident. A black elevator operator, a teenager, was on duty, and a young white girl got into the elevator, and an altercation of some kind took place between them. It never was really determined what exactly happened. But in any event, the young lady complained that she was assaulted by this black teenager, and the white residents of Tulsa went berserk. They created a mob, and they burned the Greenville Black District to the ground. They even used airplanes that would fly over and drop flaming turpentine balls on the tops of, on the roofs of the buildings that held the black businesses. And the buildings would burn from the top downwards. It was a terrible thing, and it's not just past history, even though it occurred in 1921. Just this year, there have been 3 newspaper articles about the Tulsa Race Massacre. New York Times had one in April called "In Tulsa, Clues to Massacre Victims Emerge." The Wall Street Journal in July had an article entitled "Judge Dismisses Tulsa Massacre Lawsuit, Statute of Limitations." And there was a survivor, 102 years old, who did not receive any compensation, and his case was dismissed because of the statute of limitations. And then on July 31, the New York Times had another article about the Tulsa Race Massacre called "Delayed Justice for Survivors of the Tulsa Race Massacre." Here's a picture of the Greenwood area after the devastation. And then we get to the Dust Bowl. It lasted about 10 years. Ken Burns, fabulous documentarian, made a movie or a film on PBS about the Dust Bowl. And the Dust Bowl covered not just Oklahoma, but it covered Kansas and surrounding states. It was created by several factors. One was improper farming methods. Before the natural state of the grasslands and plains, the topsoil was covered by what's known as prairie grass. The farmers came in and plowed up the prairie grass and planted crops. The crops
did not do a good job of holding down the topsoil like the prairie grasses did. And then a years-long drought occurred, and a tremendous windstorm, and the topsoil was blown away. This black cloud consists of topsoil. And here are unfortunate Oklahoma residents in their jalopies. No place to escape to. And this picture was taken after the dust and the wind settled. You can see wagons and automobiles covered with what was topsoil. A book was written about this by John Steinbeck. The Graves of Wrath. The title comes from the first verse of the battle hymn of the Republic. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. I had to look up the definition of the word wrath. It's not a word that I use very much. It means extreme anger or rage. The Grapes of Wrath is a very unhappy story about the migrants of Oklahoma who were left penniless and homeless. Many of the farmers had financed the purchase of their land, or had financed the purchase of a tractor or even horses. When their farms were devastated, they couldn't make their payments, so the banks repossessed. So they were homeless and broke. And they, I'll get to that in a second. This is the most famous picture taken by a lady photographer by the name of Dorothea Lange. Dorothea Lange was hired by the federal government to go around during the Depression and the Dust Bowl and document, take pictures of people who were down and out. And this of this mother with two little kids hanging on to her is Dorothea Lange's most famous photograph of that era. Okay. Woody Guthrie wrote at least two ballads about the Dust Bowl, and we'll see if I can play one of them.
On the 14th day of April of 1935, there struck the worst of dust storms that ever filled the sky. You could see that dust storm coming. The cloud looked death-like black, and through our mighty nation it left a dreadful track. From Oklahoma City to the Arizona line.
On top of the Dust Bowl occurring simultaneously was the Great Depression, the nationwide financial economic depression. So people were hit with a double whammy, the Dust Bowl and the Great Depression. My father, who grew up in Idaho, and many people who were teenagers at that time, rode the rails, which means he and his brother would find an open boxcar on a train, hop into the boxcar, not knowing where the train was going, and just ride it to the next stop, get off and look for work in that town. If they didn't find any work in that town, they'd get into another boxcar, and it's called riding the rails. And my father, who eventually became a CPA, started out as a guy who was riding the rails. Okay. Let's fast forward to 1995, and if you're still, if you're not too depressed, still sitting here and nobody's left, we'll talk about a terrible thing that occurred right here in Oklahoma City in 1995.
Yeah.
The bombing of the Oklahoma City federal building. How many people have heard of a person by the name of Timothy McVeigh?
Oh, yeah.
Everybody.
Damn near everybody. Okay.
I was there.
What's that?
I was there.
You were?
After the explosion with the insurance companies.
Oh, my gosh. Wow.
Wow.
Okay. Driving the truck.
Yeah.
Ouch.
So Timothy McVeigh and another guy, Army veterans.
But he went from the AFID.
They became pissed off at the federal government for what occurred in Texas at something called the Branch Davidian situation. I don't know what's about it. On the second anniversary, I guess the FBI came in and squelched some kind of a riot, killed a lot of people. Timothy McVeigh and a lot of Americans became very angry at the FBI for doing that. On the second anniversary of the Branch Davidian incident, he bombed a federal building. He rented a Ryder truck in Kansas, drove down. His assistant drove a getaway car. He loaded the truck with explosives, parked it in front of the federal building, escaped, had a timer, and the bomb went off. 116 people were killed, including 19 children under the age of 6. In addition to the 168 who were killed, 680 people were injured. The building was so damaged it had to be torn down. It couldn't be repaired, as you can obviously see that. It's very interesting how Timothy McVeigh was caught. The blast was so ferocious that truck parts of the engine, transmission, everything else were blown for blocks around. Investigators found a part with a serial number on it. And they traced that serial number to the Ryder truck agency in Kansas that McVeigh ran it under an alias. That's how they tied the truck to that Ryder truck agency. Only 90 minutes, an hour and a half after the blast, Timothy McVeigh was driving northward in his escape car, getaway car, and he was stopped by an Oklahoma policeman because the back of the vehicle didn't have a license plate. The officer walks up to the driver's side and discovers that the driver, who he didn't know, Timothy McVeigh, had a concealed weapon, didn't have a license for it. So he arrested McVeigh for no license plate and a concealed weapon. At that time, the officer had no idea that it was Timothy McVeigh that caused this bombing of the federal building. And that's how he was caught. Case, he was prosecuted, obviously, case went to a jury. The jury did not decide the guilty verdict quickly. They deliberated for 23 hours. And that tells me it's like 3 days, 8 hours a day. He was found guilty, and about 5 years after the incident,
he was killed by a lethal injection at a prison in Indiana. Here is a very sad picture of a Oklahoma City fireman holding an injured baby. Unfortunately, the baby did not survive. A memorial, Mormon Memorial Museum, has been constructed in Oklahoma City, not very far from where we are today. When OFA had its first Oklahoma City conference here, I went to the bombing museum. It's been expanded and made bigger and better since then. But it's worthwhile going to see. And I have put a paper and pencil on the table, on each table. If you're interested, you can write down the rest of the bombing museum. 201. Left this street. Okay, another. Now we're starting to get into some positive things about the book. Forget all the negative stuff. Let's think positively. I understand that the spouse of the tour yesterday included a tour of,
yes,
of this National Cowboy Western Heritage Museum. If you haven't been to it yet, time, here's the address of that. 1700 63rd. Here's the First Americans Museum, somewhere here on Wall Street. And in the southwest of the state are the Wichita Mountains. And it's a wildlife refuge where buffalo and elk roam freely. Without any fences around them, like in Africa. The tallest mountain in the Wichita Mountains is Mount Scott, and apparently people go there and do boulder hopping. Have you done any boulder hopping? Okay.
Boulder hopping. It's actually funny.
Right across the street from us, down towards the fondue restaurant, is the American Banjo Museum. It's very worthwhile seeing. Okay, finally, we're going to talk about aviation. Here, let's just start here. Raise your hand if you've ever been a passenger on OP Airlines. We have created some paper airplanes with the name OP Airlines put on the side, and Rob Cheek has Rob Cheek has
some fire. I thought you were going to do some contests.
If you or your grandsons, granddaughters would like to have a paper airplane, Oki Airlines.
We definitely want one, Rob. Wow. Yeah, we definitely want one, Rob.
Good flyers. Yeah, good flyers.
They're great flyers.
They're good students. They're playing a lot of time.
Woo!
Oh, my eyes.
Rob. Back here, Rob. That's beautiful.
And I should go back a little bit and say the word Oki, a derogatory term for residents of Oklahoma. I think
it
was created by Californians when thousands of displaced, broke, destitute Oklahoma residents traveled west of Route 66 to California, hoping to find work and start
I knew. The California residents were not very happy with all these strangers coming into the state. For every one job available in California in the 1930s or so, there were about 1,000 people, Oklahoma residents, trying to get that one job. The California residents came up with the derogatory term "okie." I believe that's the derivation of that name. Okay, let's talk about Fort Sill, the birthplace of Army combat aviation. Fort Sill started in 1869. It was a fort. It was an army fort that was created to help control the Indian wars. It's named after this gentleman here, Joshua Sill, who became a brigadier general, probably posthumously. He was killed during the Civil War, fighting for the Union at age 31. Army combat aviation began at Fort Sill, which, by the way, is located southwest of here, about 85 miles near the town of Lawton, Oklahoma. And one of the things that I was very surprised to learn is that the flight instructors for the first Army combat pilots were the Wright brothers. Huh. The Wright brothers traveled down to Fort Sill from Dayton, Ohio, and were the first CFI. There was such a thing as a CFI at the time. Anyway, they were the flight instructors. Fort Sill is one of four basic training Army bases. Another one used to be Fort Worth in California. In 1922, the busiest airfield in the United States was the airfield at Fort Sill. The Army aviation section eventually in 1954, I believe, was transferred to Fort Rucker. A lot of Army helicopter pilots, fixed wing pilots, who got orders to Vietnam received their training at Fort Sill. Okay, in 1942, well, let's talk about something that occurred nationwide here. Shortly after Pearl Harbor, an executive order signed by President Franklin Delano Roosevelt established internment camps for Japanese Americans. Internment is a nice word for a concentration camp. And there were many locations on the West Coast, and there was even one here at Fort Sill. 700 Japanese Americans, we're talking about people who are citizens of the United States. Some were like second generation citizens, and I recall hearing about a young man who had graduated from the University of California at Berkeley. He'd been admitted to medical school, and he never got there because he was interned in one of the camps. Fort Sill also was the home of a few German POWs during World War II, and Geronimo, famous Apache warrior Geronimo is buried at in the cemetery at Fort Sill. Fast forward to 1967 at Fort Sill. friends and family of a fallen soldier gathered for a funeral. A first sergeant had been killed in Nam as he tried to drag one of his men off the battlefield. He had been awarded 42 medals that he had earned for his service in World War II, Korea, and posthumously in Vietnam. He, this first sergeant, he and his son, a Native American, he and his three sons were among 42,000 Native Americans who served in Vietnam. Okay, Spartan Aviation is its headquarters in Tulsa. I'm past my time a little bit here, I'll speed it up. Let John Morris can have a Zoom maybe.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. The FAA Mike Monroney Aeronautical Center is located adjacent to the Will Rogers Airport. 7,500 employees work at the FAA there. And it covers almost every aspect of the FAA does. Named after Oklahoma Senator Mike Monroney. Mike Monroney personally wrote the FAA Act of 1958 that was signed into law, and the FAA replaced the CAA, the Civil Aviation Administration, in 1958. Okay, here's a photograph of a mythical or typical air traffic controller in a tower. And the reason why I have this is because one of the things I learned, and this is in jest, is that the FAA employs speech pathologists. Why? To teach ATC people to speak so damn fast. And that result in this typical message from the pilot. Okay, let's talk about some flying machines just for fun that have absolutely nothing to do with Oklahoma, but are interesting. 1901, this airship is flying around the Eiffel Tower in Paris. The very first aviation fatality occurred in 1908 when Lieutenant Thomas Selfridge somehow fell from this aircraft. Here's a weird contraption here.
Wow.
I don't know whether it ever got off the ground. And this is one of my favorite photographs. In England in 1911, they were having an air show, they're preparing for an air show at the Hendon Airfield somewhere outside of London. And the spectators were prohibited from going inside to see the airplanes, and so these guys cheated, and they dressed up in suits and put hats on and stood on the seats of their bicycles to look over the fence to see what was on the other side. Airplanes are gone. There's an aircraft landing on a battleship deck in 1911. Here's where it all began, the Wright Cycle Company. Wingwalkers on a Cessna aircraft. I counted there's 28 men standing on these wings, a publicity stunt to brag of how strong the wings were. An early NASA wind tunnel, and right there you can see how big it is if there's men near the top of the ladder there.
Is that you?
Jimmy Doolittle taking off from aircraft carrier Hornet to bomb Tokyo. A very impressive statistic, or not, a very impressive thing is that this bombing run
occurred like 3 or 4 months after Pearl Harbor. So the Americans were able to train these pilots to do stall takeoffs, and the white lines right there on the left side of the carrier deck are intended to guide the pilots as they did their takeoff roll on the deck. So the tip of the right wing would not hit the island of the aircraft carrier. The reason why I have a picture of a perfectly good B-52 is because about 5 years ago, I was a tourist in Vietnam, and I came across this.
Wow.
Yeah. A B-52 wreckage in Hanoi. They built a concrete pad below it, but the only thing you can recognize is the tail. And the Vietnam are very proud of the number of B-52s that they shot down. This aircraft landed like that and apparently just was stuck. It didn't fall forwards or backwards. Here's a, this is not a real photograph. glad you recognize that.
Hawaiian Airlines.
Okay. And you probably can figure out what this is.
It works.
Yeah. Take your trial to work. If pigs could fly, that's a favorite saying of this gentleman over here, Hap Arnold. Is that correct, Hap?
I love pigs flying.
Who's this guy? It's our leader, Hap Arnold.
That is the fly.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. Hap, if you will please tell us.
Wow.
Tell us, Hap, what you were flying before this was taken and so forth.
I think it was probably not in Michigan. It's the longest my hair has ever been in my life. F4C.
Yeah.
Pretty good at F4C.
Yeah, that is what I just got around. Yeah.
Okay. And then I'm closing out with some of America's most famous persons in aviation. The most famous American is a chimpanzee. His name was Ham, and he was the first chimpanzee in space, 1961. I believe the purpose of transporting this poor monkey into space was to see whether he could survive under conditions, and if he could survive, maybe human beings could survive. They used a chimpanzee as a guinea pig or as a guinea chimpanzee. And him, the chimpanzee, did survive, and he was given an award. He was given an apple. You can see him reaching for the apple with his right hand with a big grin on his face. Wally Post was the first American, maybe the first person worldwide to fly, circumnavigate the globe. The time he did this in 1930, the record for circumnavigating the globe was not held by an airplane. It was held by the Graf Zeppelin. It took 29 days for the Graf Zeppelin to go around the Earth, and took Wally Post 8 days. Here's Clyde Cessna. His company was eventually acquired by Textron. Piper Aircraft. Anybody know the current owner of Piper Aircraft? The government of Brunei. B-R-U-N-E-I. I had to look up on a map. Where the hell is Brunei?
Asia.
Okay. Walter Beach.
His company was also acquired, and I think it's now part of Boeing, if I'm not mistaken.
Textron
owns them, yep.
Okay, Textron. Nell is the founder of Douglas Aircraft Company. The DC-3s, for the most part, they're built in several states, including Kansas and Santa Monica Airport. In the early 70s, I was working for a law firm in its office at the Santa Monica Airport on the south side of the runway. On the north side of the runway was abandoned big green buildings, and that was where the DC-3s were made on the West Coast. During World War II, Japanese submarines would surface off the coast of California and Oregon and Washington and shoot artillery shells into the United States mainland. In anticipation of that, the entire Douglas aircraft factory at the Santa Monica Airport was camouflaged. Giant tarps and fabrics and so forth were put over the buildings so it would not be apparent that it was an aircraft factory. Santa Monica Airport, for those of you don't know, is like 1 mile from the ocean or less. That's where I learned to fly.
Yeah.
Okay. William Lear, the founder of Learjet, started out with inventing the car radio. Bert Rutan, who eventually created scaled composites, very creative aeronautical engineer. Amelia Earhart, of course, I mentioned her, famous American aviator, aviatrice, whatever the word is. Then we have Curtis LeMay, who, among many of General Curtis LeMay's achievements and positions of responsibility, is he was the coordinator of the Berlin Airlift. The Berlin Airlift occurred in 1948-1949, and it lasted for 15 months. As many of you know, the city of Berlin in 1948 was completely surrounded by land controlled by Russia. And there was the only way that you could get to Berlin was by train or truck. Well, the Soviets closed those avenues off, and Curtis LeMay became the coordinator of the famous Berlin Airlift. The Berlin Airlift was an amazing achievement. Over 270,000 flights occurred during the 15-month period. The gentleman here in the audience had an agreement.
They did not have an awful lot when I was overseas yet.
Okay. Great.
Why have two buildings to get in there?
It was so amazing that aircraft loaded with supplies, even including a few aircraft loaded with coal, imagine aircraft loaded with coal, aircraft were landing at Tempelhof and maybe one or two other airports in Berlin every 30 seconds. Wow. It was an incredible achievement. Aircraft from England, France, and the United States. And he was the guy who coordinated it.
Yes.
Curtis LeMay passed away at age 83 near March Air Force Base at a retirement community located, maybe a retirement community for Air Force officers, located adjacent to March Air Force Base. Sally Ride, the first woman in space. Unfortunately, she died at a relatively young age, age 61. And I'm almost done here. You'll be pleased to know. We'll end with four very famous American aviators: Lindbergh, Yeager, and these two.
Bob, I said I told you to burn the evidence.
Okay. One more slide, but before I get to that, I wanted to thank OFA for providing me with the motivation to learn a lot of history about Oklahoma and Kansas and other states. I learned more about history preparing for these OFA history things, much more history than I ever learned in college. Thank you, OFA.
Thank you, Jim McKay. Way to go, Jim.
Good job. You have a good idea.